and we will take that into account when it's my need, when it's needed to think about which treatment you want to focus on. So it's just come down to me now. Thank you very much for coming. We will stay tuned back and I look forward to many more of these in the future. Thank you.
Hello again, it's an event like this, and I'm absolutely thrilled to come. I'm delighted to meet you guys for helping us so much with our project that's coming along time after time for clinic. And I listen to the work that Michelle and her clinical colleagues are doing, they're talking today, and I think it's fantastic. So a huge thank you to you for this, giving your time with and Michelle and her clinical fellows for driving around the Thames Valley region, which you've kind of extended up to Sheffield to take on the big patients and all your efforts. So our other work is to work with cell models in particular, to try to answer this question. Now this is a really hard question, so we're still giving many patients L-DOPA, which we've been giving for about the last 50 years or so. How do we do something better? So it's a really difficult question to tackle, and I want to tell you that we're working very hard at it, but it is difficult. But it is the ultimate aim, it is what we're here for in the end, to try and develop new drug products. Drug discovery has not been working in the last 10 or 20 years or so. Drug development process is long. It takes a long time to think up the ideas of what might make a good drug. It takes a long time through this pre-clinical phase, where we work in the laboratory, then move into the clinic in phase 1, 2, 3 for final approval. It takes a long time, 10 years or more, and it's extremely expensive for 1 billion. Parkinson's UK have generous enough funding, but they've not given us a billion. But what we're doing is working our way down at this end here to try to develop new ideas. It's also getting harder. So this graph here is purple, which goes up, shows the money that's been spent on research to try to develop the drugs, which has been going up, and this line in yellow is the number of drugs that have been approved for use across many different diseases. So the money that's going in is going up, and the number of drugs that are being developed is staying constant, or even actually now falling, so it's getting harder. Many different reasons for this, perhaps because people haven't been asking the right questions or using the right models, using, say, cells and patients, for example, which are probably the best things to use. So we've got three reasons why we think we can give it a better go for targeting drug discovery here at the Parkinson Centre, and three reasons. The first is that we've studied many different types of cellular models. We've made cells and neurons from patients, for some of you. We've also made cells from rats and mice, because they make Parkinson's. But they seem to have the same cellular problems, which suggests that we're onto the right thing. We're also able to use very new techniques to interrogate cellular pathology to look at all the genes, see which genes are expressed, look at all the proteins and all the metabolites within cells, try to see what's different between patients and controls. And thirdly, as I'll show you towards the end, we've had the funding from the Medical Research Council, the MRC, to put in place some really world-class facilities and tap into the expertise of others here in Oxford in targeted drug discovery to apply to puzzles. So three routes. How are we going to do it? First, use the genes. Understand the genetics. So we're able to identify individuals who carry genetic changes to contribute to their Parkinson's. We've made stem cells from skin biopsies, and some of you in the room, and then make neuron brain cells from those skin cells. So this is a process which we've been running for about 5 years now. Michelle, a member of our clinical team, will take a skin biopsy from a patient, bring that back to the lab, stop it in a little bit, lie the cells fall to the bottom of a plastic dish where we grow the cells. Sally Cowley, a researcher working in the Dunn School of Pathology, is able to convert skin cells into stem cells, and then in my own laboratory, we're able to turn these stem cells into neurons, hopefully neurons, very similar to the ones that are dying in the brain. And this gives us Parkinson's disease in a dish. We can study these neurons for patients to better understand them, compare them to healthy neurons, and understand why these neurons are dying. So we've been doing this for a number of years. Why do we want to do it? Well, we want to understand the cellular pathways, understand what we call the cellular phenotype. What's the problem? What's the difference about these cells to understand why they died? This gives us a window into the disease. So genetic Parkinson's is rare, maybe only 2 or 3% of patients have a genetic change. But it allows us to understand this working laboratory, and we hope that will inform us on that more common sporadic form. Hopefully we can give us cellular evidence to support the clinical findings. So because Michelle and her team have worked so hard not to just diagnose Parkinson's, but in the cohort of specific subtypes of Parkinson's, understand stratification. Maybe those cells in the dish behave differently depending on whether they come from a patient, for example, who had Parkinson's disorder or didn't. And also we're working to support biomarker discovery, so we're able to take the blood samples that you've given, or the CSF samples, and see if we can find protein changes in there that might predict Parkinson's. We can also take the medium, the liquid that we grow these cells in the lab, to see if we can find proteins released into that medium that might tell us about biomarkers in the blood. And ultimately, once we have these cells and we know which one, we can screen for therapeutic molecules, put the problem right in cells, maybe that will work in patients. Making these stem cells of our neurons now for a number of years. On the left is an image, a microscopic image that we take in the laboratory showing neurons that we've grown in red, and dopamine neurons, these are neurons we really want to study, are in green, so these are the ones we wish to study. And we can see on the right, these cells have electrical activity, that's what neurons do, they fire electrical signals, so we can see this through the imaging here, and then also through the electrical analysis here. So these neurons are exactly what they should. So we can now grow these in patients and control them, and also this one. So we might have looked perhaps at the electrical activity, these neurons will fire, far away about 5 or 10 times a second, giving an electrical signal. Maybe that's different in the patient to control. We haven't found anything yet. We look at chemical release, so these neurons are releasing dopamine, maybe the neurons of patients and the controls release dopamine slightly differently. We haven't found that yet. Maybe it's to do with energy. That's the picture of a mitochondria, the powerhouses within the cells that produce our energy.